Listening Library presents Tempests and Slaughter, The Numair Chronicles, Book 1, by Tamora Pierce. Read for you by Ari Meyers. Chapter 1. August 30th to September 1st, 435. The Imperial Colosseum, Thak City. The Carthaki Empire. Aram Draper hung on the rail of the great arena, hoisting himself until his belly was bent over the polished stone. It was the only way he could get between the two bulky men who blocked his view. He knew it was risky, but he couldn't waste his first chance to see the gladiators when they marched into the huge stadium. His father and grandfather were back at their seats, arguing about new business ventures. They weren't paying attention, waving him off when he asked to visit the privies, and never realizing he'd squirmed his way down to the rail instead. Apart from them, he was alone. There were no friends from school for company. They all said he was too young. He was 11, well, 10 in truth, but he told them he was 11. Even that didn't earn him friends among his older schoolfellows. Still, he wasn't a baby. If he didn't see the games with his family today, he might never get the chance. And he'd learned only last night he might not see Papa again for 2 years, even 3. Carthak was a costly voyage for Yusuf Draper, and his new venture would take him away for a long time. But in the morning, Aram would be able to tell the older students that he had watched the games right from the arena wall. Already he'd heard the trumpets and drums announcing the arrival of the emperor and his heirs. He couldn't see their faces, but surely all the sparkling gold, silver, and gems meant the wearers were part of the imperial family. He could see the grand crier, who stood on a platform halfway between him and the royals. More important, he could plainly hear the man's booming voice as he announced the emperor's many titles and those of his heirs.
"Look it!"
The bruiser on Aram's left bumped him as he pointed north to the emperor's dais. Aram wobbled and might have pitched headfirst onto the sands 20 feet below if the man on his other side hadn't caught him by the belt and hauled him inside the rail. Without appearing to notice Aram's near fall, the man on the left went on to say,
"There's the widow and her son. She never comes to games."
"Who's the widow?" Aram asked. "Who's the son?"
The big men grinned at each other over his head.
"For all you're a brown boy, you don't know your imperials," said the one who had bumped him. "The widow is Princess Mahira, that was married to Prince Apadon. He was killed fighting rebels 2 years back," the other man said. "And the boy is Prince Ozorn."
Now Aram remembered. Ozorn was a year or two ahead of him at the lower academy. From the podium, the crier bellowed that the emperor would bless the games. Everyone thundered to their feet and then hushed, his voice amplified, most likely by a mage. The emperor prayed to the gods for an excellent round of games. When he finished, everyone sat. For a very long moment, the arena was still. Then the boy felt a slow, regular thudding rise through the stone and up his legs. His body shuddered against the railing. Nearby, in the wall that took up a third of the southern end of the arena, huge barred gates swung inward. Here came drummers and trumpeters, clad only in gold-trimmed scarlet loincloths. Their oiled bodies gleamed as brightly as the polished metal of their instruments. The brawny men represented every race of the empire in the colors of their skin and hair and the tattoos on their faces and bodies. One thing they had in common, iron slave rings around their throats. Aram rubbed his own throat uneasily. His original home, Tira, was not a slave country. 3 years in Carthak had not made him comfortable with the practice, not when there were no slaves at his school. He saw them only when he was outside, and the sight of them made him edgy. The leader of the musicians raised his staff. The trumpeters let loose a blare that made Aram jump, almost tipping him over the rail. The men caught him again.
You're best off at your seat, the friendly one advised. Ain't your mama calling you?
I'm 11, Aram lied. I don't need a mother. I'm a student at the school for mages.
The men's laughter was drowned out by a thunder of drum rolls. Aram gave the sands what he called his special magical squint. Now he saw waves of spells all over the arena floor. They sent ripples through the air, carrying the arena's noise even to the people in the seats high above.
Why do they allow spells on the arena sand?
He shouted at the friendlier of the two men. As far as he knew, magic was forbidden here. Perhaps they allowed only their own magic, just as they allowed the Emperor's magic.
What spells?
The man bellowed. He reached over Aram's head and tapped his friend as the musicians marched past.
The lad thinks there's magic on the sands.
The other roughneck looked down his flattened nose at Aram. A couple of scars on his face told the boy he may have come by that nose in fighting.
What are you, upstart?
He growled.
Some kind of mage?
Of course I am, Aram retorted. Didn't you hear me say I'm in the school for mages?
He's simple,
the friendlier man said.
Leave him be. Who are you betting on?
The other man seized Aram by the collar and lifted him into the air.
If you're a mage, spell me then,
he growled.
Turn me into something before I break your skinny neck for bothering us.
Don't be stupid,
Aram cried. His mind, as always, had fixed on the question of magic.
Only a great mage can turn a person into something else. Even
his foe choked off Aram's next comment, that he might never be a great mage, by turning his fist to cut off the boy's voice entirely.
Stupid, am I?
He shouted, his eyes bulging.
You moneyed little piece of tripe!
Aram might have corrected him concerning the state of his pocketbook, but he couldn't breathe and had finally remembered a teacher's advice. You don't make friends when you tell someone you think he is stupid. He was seeing light bursts against a darkening world. He called up the first bit of magic he'd ever created after a walk on a silk carpet brought flames to his fingers. He drew that magic from the sands and seized the fist on his collar. The tough yelped and released Aram instantly.
You! What did you do to me?
Aram couldn't answer. He hit the rail and went over backwards, arms flailing. He was trying to think of life-saving magic when a pair of strong, dark brown arms caught him just before he struck the ground. He looked into a man's face, eyes so brown they seemed black in the bright sun, a flattened nose, a grinning mouth, and holes in both earlobes. His head was shaved.
You don't want to join us, lad. Trust me, you don't.
He told Aram, already walking back against the line of marching gladiators. The ones closest to them were laughing and slapping or punching the big man on the shoulder. Like him, they wore leather armor. Like him, they were oiled all over. Some were missing ears or eyes. These were the beginners, the mid-level fighters, and the old-timers, not the heroes of the arena. Some didn't look at Aram. They were murmuring to themselves or fondling tiny god images that hung on cords around their necks.
Hurry, boy,
an older gladiator muttered to Aram's rescuer.
Guards coming.
You don't want the guards catching you,
the big man explained to Aram as he quickened his pace.
They'll rip you before they cut you loose. Is your family here?
Sitting in the copper section,
Aram said miserably. He had no idea how he'd get back to Papa and Granda.
Don't fuss,
the big man told him.
We'll fix it.
Aram smelled something odd, like a barnyard thick with hay and dung. The ground under his rescuer shook. The boy looked up and cringed. Massive gray shapes approached, swaying as the sands thundered beneath their broad, flat feet. They waved huge, snake-like trunks painted in brightly colored stripes, circles, and dots. He had never been so close to an elephant. One halted in front of them as the others followed the parade.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.